Good evening, and thank you for joining us on our show, Dog is Family, where we celebrate the bond between people and their dogs. And we want to do everything we can to nurture their lives and bring the best that we can to them. We talk about their mind, body, and spirit, and we're so glad that you joined us tonight. Thank you for staying with us. We have wonderful topics to talk about tonight. I'm going to show you this first, and we're going to get back to that maybe and talk about why this might be important. It's a hot topic in dogdom, and it's something that can come in very handy for you at home with your dog. But you know what? We're going to get started right away. It's a delight to be in this studio tonight, and I'd like to introduce the guest that we have on the show. Sitting to my left is Dr. Christina Vittoria. Hi. Dr. Vittoria.
Really excited to be here.
We are so grateful that you are. I can't wait till you share your topic with the viewers. And next to Dr. Vittoria is our resident dog, certified dog trainer, Denise Lacey. Hi, Denise.
Hi, Barb. Back again.
Yeah, back again. We want to have her back as much as possible. She's got all kind of training tips for us. So with that in mind, I'd like you to get your pencil and paper out because I think you're going to want to take some notes tonight. So right away, this first topic that we're going to be talking about is one that seems to affect a lot of people and their dogs. And it has to do with being very interested in positive rewards-based training, which we've talked about a few times on our show. But what do you do when your dog isn't food motivated? And Denise has wonderful tips for that. So I'm going to turn the program over right to her. Denise, take it away. We don't know what to do about this situation. How can you help us, Barb?
So we have talked before about using positive reinforcement for our training. And what we're looking at is, you know, when we're working with our dog and they do what we want, what can we do to let them know that they've successfully completed that behavior? And we've talked about using a marker to mark the behavior. So the question becomes, well, what do you use as a reinforcer? And the answer is that you can use anything that the dog finds rewarding, finds worthwhile to work for. So for humans, it tends to be money. Most of us go to jobs for cash, although we were joking beforehand that we have yet to find a dog that will work for cash. College students, pizza works really well. You need to get college students to do something. Free food is usually a way to get them to show up. So for our dogs, lots of times we do talk about using food as our reinforcer because it's easy to use. It's available. We can break it into tiny pieces. We give it to them. They swallow it. It's gone. We're ready to do another repetition of our training. But some dogs are not really interested in food when it comes to training times. And there can be a number of reasons for that. Some dogs are picky eaters. They're just not really driven by food. Sometimes you can look at different treats to find things that are more interesting for them. I've got a couple here. We have a beef treat here, a rabbit. Here's some buffalo. And then this one is the one that I have yet to find a dog that refuses. It's salmon. And you can't tell on television, but if I were to open this bag, it reeks. It's just atrocious smelling. You use it, your hands stink of salmon. But what I found is that for lots of dogs, because they have such an amazing sense of smell, stinkier is better. So if you're doing food training and you hold up your treats and you sniff them and there's not really much of an odor, that may be part of the reason that your dog's not getting excited over food. And looking for something smelly might change their attitude about food. The other thing that can impact is how long has it been since they had a meal that you're doing your training with food. If you've just fed your dog dinner, they may not really be into more food at that point in time. Some people do meals with their dogs. Other people do what we call free feeding when they leave food down all the time. If you free feed your dog, imagine if you had been at an all-you-can-eat buffet, just finished eating, and somebody tried to feed you another brownie. You'd be like, "Yeah, no thanks, not right now." So sometimes if you do free feeding, taking up that food bowl an hour or two before you're going to try your training session can make a difference in how interested your dog is working for food. So those are a couple things that you can do to help get them more interested in food, and again, checking out different treats. So we've tried all this. Our dogs still are not interested in food. So what else can we use for reinforcers? As I said at the beginning, anything your dog is interested in. So, petting, toys, playing with a ball, tug. Look at what your dog does naturally for play. Does your dog like to grab things and have you chase them around the house? Maybe getting them to sit and then playing a little chase game with them will be something that they enjoy. The thing that happens when we go to using things other than food is that the reinforcement process does take a little bit longer, so it takes longer to do repetitions of behavior. If I'm feeding my dog treats, they sit, I mark it, I give them a treat, I can immediately ask them to do another behavior or another sit. When you're doing play and toys, you have to get the toy back from the dog. Perhaps that involves chasing them down and prying it out of their mouths. So your training session becomes slower, but if it's a reward that the dog is interested in working for, you'll find over time that you'll still accomplish them learning behavior. So how do you know if your dog likes something? So a lot of people think, oh, my dog must like petting. Well, you can actually do a test to see if your dog enjoys petting or not. So go, if you normally scratch their chest, rub their head, go and do that for 3 or 4 seconds and then take your hand away and see what your dog does. Do they move closer to try and get you to resume the petting? Are they just fine that you quit? Do they get up and walk away? If your dog is coming in closer, they're letting you know, hey, do that again, I liked that. My dog at home, if she's laying belly up, loves having her belly rubbed, and if I stop, she is all paws trying to get me to do it more. So I have a very clear indicator from her. She likes that. And so that tells me I can use that as a reinforcer. I can also use toys as a reinforcer, and we have lots of different ones here. A lot of people think of like a ball, and maybe your dog does like balls. They make ones that squeak. Sometimes the squeaky noise gets dogs interested. If you have a dog that enjoys frisbee, throwing the frisbee for them to bring back to you when they've successfully done a behavior. Bumpers, some of the retrievers really like to carry things around in their mouth, tossing that, and letting them carry it around for a while. Maybe you ask them to do a sit and a down couple behaviors before they get it. And then some dogs are not really into toys, but maybe are into food and you'd like to get them interested in playing. And this is one of the many stuff it toys out now. You put the food inside, close it up, smells like food, gets the dog interested in it. So you can also help your dog learn to enjoy toys with that. And then there's a variety of different tug things. This one happens to have a tennis ball on it. You can just have a fleece tug and play tug with your dog as a reinforcer. So again, the sky's the limit for the things that your dog enjoys and likes to participate in. A lot of people have asked me over the years, is it okay to play tug with my dog? You know, do I need to make sure I win? And there's a lot of different information out there, but in general, yes, it's fine to play tug with your dog. If you find that you're always winning, you're probably taking the games on too long. Your dog needs to win sometimes. Sometimes let go and let them have the toy. If you think about it, if you were playing with somebody else, some sort of a board game or something, and they beat you every time, it wouldn't be very long before when they said, hey, you want to play? You're like, no thanks, got other things to do. So you need to let your dog win occasionally as well, and that will not cause any problems in your relationship. It's sort of that give and take of it's a game, and sometimes you win and sometimes I win. So we talked about dogs that didn't like food. We can use other things as reinforcers. So what happens if we feel like we just have a dog that doesn't like anything? They don't like food, they don't like toys. Well, you can work on creating a toy that your dog will enjoy playing with. You do that by limiting access. And if you've ever been around kids, and I tend to think of dogs as perpetual toddlers, fair or not, if a toy disappears for a couple of weeks and then reappears, suddenly it's the brand new favorite, even though they had unlimited access to it for a year before it went on its week hiatus. So pick a toy that you think is the one that you want to make your dog's favorite. Put it away. Don't let them have access to it unless they're engaged in playing with you. Get it out, play with it, tease them with it a little bit, put it away again. And then see if you, after a couple sessions, drag it across the floor a little. Are they interested in it? If you're worried about them latching onto your fingers, this is a great use for the handle end of your leash. If you put your hand through and grab and pull it out, you can then take this and attach it around any toy and use that to drag the toy along the ground for your dog to chase you, creating a chase game where if your dog bites the toy, they're not getting your hands. So that's something you can do as well. So again, a way to start creating a new interest for your dog. We're looking for it to be about engaging and playing with you. Another thing to keep in mind, maybe your dog starts out a training session having a good time and after a little bit is not so interested in training anymore. You're looking at training versus drilling. Sometimes your best training sessions are ones that you keep really short, just a couple repetitions, and then end the session and let your dog go on and do something else rather than going on and on and on with a behavior that they're successfully doing. So keeping sessions short can help out, and sometimes your non-food motivated dogs are interested in taking 2, 3, 4 treats, and then you can end a session while they're still interested in the food. And if you're working on new skills, that's learning for your dogs. That's tough, just like it is for us to learn new skills. So make sure that you're splitting those training sessions up with sessions where you work on skills that your dogs already know and find easy to do. So a little bit on the new hard stuff, a little bit of time spent on the easy stuff. We all like a break sometimes when we're working on things. So hopefully that gives you some things to consider.
Very, very interesting. Thank you, Denise. I know it's a challenge. We hear it a lot in the shop, and they need to think creatively about different ways to approach it. So appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Next, we're going to switch gears, and we're going to be talking about a very important topic that comes up almost every day, I say, in the business that I'm in, and that's my dog has allergies. And it's a blanket statement that's used in many cases. In many cases, it's not really true. So we have, again, as our guest tonight, Dr. Christina Vittoria, who I'm very happy to have here. Let me just read you a little bit of her bio. You might already know her. She received her veterinary degree, DVM, from Tufts University School in 2000. She then completed a one-year large animal ambulatory medicine internship at Cornell. She joined Willow Creek Veterinary Center in March of 2002. And when she's not treating equine patients, she is treating dogs and cats in the Small Animal Center at Willow Creek. Many of you might know her as a contributing writer of Berks Country magazine as Ask the Horse Vet. I know many of you enjoy her article that's written every week. In addition to writing, she tells us that she enjoys hiking, reading, and racing goats.
Yes.
So welcome, Dr. Vittoria. Please take it away and help her, folks.
Thank
you. Delightful.
So I'm not going to talk about the goat racing, although that is a whole other subject, and maybe someday we can bring our goats on the on your show. That would be fun.
Training and clicker training.
Yes, clicker training goats. I don't know. But tonight I'm here to talk about dog and cat allergies, and it is a big and fairly serious situation with a lot of pets that people do, like you said, sort of misconceive or misconstrue their dog's itching to be just a straight allergy, be it a food allergy or an environmental allergy. And sometimes what happens is that you get a lot of misunderstanding as to what your dog or cat is allergic to. And that is something that I do see with a lot of patients, including my own. I recently adopted a cat from a farm for my parents, which they didn't know, and it was the best Father's Day gift my dad ever said. Unfortunately, Peppino had allergies at a very young age, and I suspected as such. So we did do some allergy testing, and I actually have his information here to share with you guys as well. It's very well timed, but I'm gonna have you guys switch over to the slides because I prepared some slides for you guys to kind of help go through as I talk. So you don't have to just stare at me through the segment. So dog and cat allergies, this is basically just gonna be a brief overview. You can come in and see me at the clinic and we can talk a lot more about allergies in general. But types of allergies are composed of three essence, three components basically. So there's three essences of the allergy component that I have to deal with patients. Environmental allergies are very common in people as well as pets. We see allergies to tree pollens, weed pollens, molds, and then we also have a parasitic component. The parasitic component can be like a flea bite. Some cats and dogs are allergic to like one flea bite, no joke, and their whole skin will end up becoming irritated. And also you can have mites or mange, and that can be perceived as an allergy, but it's actually an infection. And then also food can be a contributing factor to why your animal's itching. And allergies aren't just necessarily itchy skin like we think. It's also vomiting, diarrhea, et cetera. So I try to let most of my clients know that allergies are very complex. It's not just a straightforward, oh, it's just food allergic, or the dog is just environmentally allergic. It's often a compounding factor between all of these elements. And the most frustrating thing that will be frustrating to both me as a vet and also my clients is that allergies are never cured. They're only controlled. And you can have allergies come and go in an animal's life. You can have allergies start up usually by the age of 3, or you can have them develop a little bit later in life. So we're just gonna go over some of the symptoms that we see. Itchy skin, and the one thing that I see a lot of report from my clients are is the flushed red skin. Mm. Sometimes it's from laying in the grass, if the dog's grass allergic or pollen allergic, when the tree pollens are really high, that'll lay on the grass, the actual pollen will lay on the grass, and the dog will go and be like, oh, I love the grass, look at me, I'm rolling my grass. And then all of a sudden the owners are like, oh my God, he's got pimples all over his belly and his skin's red. And then we also see a secondary skin infection actually come as a follow-up to that. Ear infections and anal gland issues are very commonly reported in dogs that have allergies, whether they're environmental or food related. And then vomiting and diarrhea. And vomiting and diarrhea is pretty much just linked to your food allergy dogs. We don't typically see that with a, oh, hey, yeah. So there's some tree pollen, I think I want to puke. Like, I guess if you're grass allergic and you eat the grass, you're going to have some problems. The allergy testing that we have available to us, it's actually been a great thing that's come in the last probably 10 to 20 years. The skin prick test is the gold standard. It is pricey and usually has to be done with a dermatologist. So that's not something that's as readily available to my clients. There are blood tests that are available that have become very, very useful for us as veterinarians to be able to give clients the information about the allergy groups. So we can test for mosquitoes, we can test for fleas, we can test for the food allergies. There's about 25-ish different foods that they'll test for dogs, and they do a different one with the company that we use for cats, which is nice because cats do have different ingredients that are in their food, such as tomato, who knew? They actually do test for tomato. It's in a lot of foods that you don't even realize. However, the dogs, they don't typically see that. So that is available. And then also, I didn't put this on there, but the NutriScan test is one that's available. That's also a saliva-based test. And that one has its own degree of pros and cons as to what it's going to give you. And honestly, doing all three would be the best idea to get the most, but no one is going to be able to afford that usually to get that whole picture. So this is an example of the spectrum allergy, and I'm sure you guys are going to have to come really close to your TV at home. But this is my cat Pepino, my parents' cat Pepino's test. And in the left-hand side, we see he's grass allergic, he has weed allergies, he's not too tree allergic. But however, the fungus is really high for him. So in the fall or the winter, when the things are dying, or that he's going down in the basement where there's like molds, yeah, he's going to have problems. And on his food allergy, which I don't know if you can see, he's actually only allergic to three things. Now keep in mind, he's young. He's only about 2 years old. He hasn't had time to develop a lot of allergies. However, we have been seeing him vomiting after he eats food about 20 minutes later, which is pretty typical. And of course, the food that I gave him, he's allergic to brewer's yeast. That is the only thing it has in it that he's allergic to. And so brewer's yeast is on this test. He's positive. And so I had to call my dad up and say, hey, Dad, stop feeding the cat the canned food that I gave you. Uh-huh. So that's something that's very helpful. And he does get diarrhea as well. So I'm hoping that as we change his foods and find things that are more acceptable to his body, he'll actually stop having these symptoms of the vomiting, the diarrhea. He does get the itchy skin. I'm not believing that I'm going to cure him with just the food. However, with the allergy shots, a lot of people have it in their head that allergy shots are going to cure the cat, because we think of with humans, that's what we see. With 25% of animals, we see a lot of improvement. About 50% of animals, it's like, yeah, you know, you get some improvement maybe. And about 25% of animals, you get nothing. So it's a lot of money to put out. And some clients they have to be aware of taking that risk that you're going to be putting that money out with the hope of helping your animal. But there's a fairly decent chance that you could have not the improvement that you want. And it can take up to a year for that to improve. Now, you got to keep in mind with food allergies, it's a simple treatment. It's not a shot. It's just avoid it. Find out what you're allergic to and avoid it. The old way of doing it was you picked some foods, you got an idea like, oh, I think I'm gonna feed him duck and green peas, and put the animal on that, give it a month, because it takes 1 month for the old food proteins to get out of the body of the animal to then be completely rid of that you can say, okay, is this new food working or not? However, if your dog or cat is like mine and is allergic to brewer's yeast, you picked wrong. So it's nice that you have this test. The one thing I try to push with my clients is that if it's not on the allergy test, please don't feed it, because you do not know if they're allergic. I had a dog that practically got hospitalized because he had a banana wrapped around a piece of dried chicken. Not allergic to chickens, very allergic to bananas apparently, and ended up with diarrhea that basically hospitalized him. He was a very food allergic dog. So diet, the one thing to keep in mind is that it's not a one-size-fits-all type situation. Not all dogs or cats are going to be allergic to the same foods. A lot of people come out with the, oh, grains are bad, and grains are bad in a lot of pets, but as you can see on Pepino's report, it's not. He could eat corn, he could eat wheat, it's not going to affect him at all. However, he can't have burrs, you see, and he can't have beef or milk for that cat. For a cat to be allergic to milk, he's kind of got the short end of that stick, but it is what it is, and he's not going to get any. And then diets, the commercial versus veterinary, there are a lot of good commercial diets available and that are out there. But keep in mind that a lot of your ingredients are not guaranteed. In some places, if they have foods that are, or some companies, if they're feeding rabbit, they will swap it out for chicken, and they don't have anyone watching. So you do have to watch the company you're using to make sure that it's a very good quality company that has good ethical standards. Or your veterinary prescription foods, they do not substitute. My one cat is on duck and green pea, and I can't get it anymore because they can't source the duck. So I'm looking for an alternative now. So we're probably going with rabbits, poor rabbits. So, sorry, rabbits, my cats need to eat. The one thing I try to let everyone know is this is a lifetime disease. They're going to usually develop their allergies by the age of 3. However, you can have changes in those food allergies. You can have changes in the environmental allergies as well. And you may need to retest. So if you've been on a food and everything's going great and you know your cat or dog has an allergy, and all of a sudden it's, oh gosh, they're really itching again, and you know it's the same symptoms, or maybe it's time to repeat that. Or look at your food. Does it have blueberries in it? I can't tell you if your dogs or cats are allergic. We don't test for it. There's just so many different food substances out there that we can't test for. We just try to hit the ones that are the most common in foods and that they're most allergenic. And also keep in mind your pet may need medication to help through those seasons because allergies are complex. You're not going to have it all solved with food if they're environmentally allergic to molds, pollens, trees, etc. So you may need some antihistamines, etc. So. And that's all I have for right now. And
oh, it's wonderful.
I know. I feel like it's a quick
Dr. Vittoria. Could you tell the folks, could you briefly run down the meat proteins that might be in that kind of testing?
Basically, now this is the cat version.
Okay.
So what you guys saw on the slide is basically going to be the same thing. But there's beef, rabbit, there's poultry mix where they actually mix turkey and chicken together, pork, venison, and then we also see lamb, salmon. They do separate salmon out from seafood and fish mix because that is different. Mm-hmm. They also run, for the cats, they run tuna as a separate entity. And for the dogs, again, they're going to be doing, I believe, I'm not sure if the rabbit, did I say that? Yeah, rabbit is on here. So there is rabbit on here as well. I don't know if I said that. And for the cats, also egg protein's really common. In a lot of cat foods, it's tuna and eggs, pate, and milk substances as well. Now for dogs, they do run peanut butter. They do not run peanuts on cats because you're not going to get a cat to take a pill with peanut butter. However, cheese, yes, and the milk substances, like poor Pepino is never going to be eating cheese again. So.
Or the ice cream dishes. But I do think data helps to at least help us move forward in a plan. Rather than picking and choosing in an unscientific way, at least the folks can have
a guide
to look at numbers
that,
depending on where they're ranging, will really work. So thank you for that. Very quick, very brief summary. She's a world of knowledge
I'm very happy to be here.
And she did mention NutriScan, which is something else that people have used, that the saliva, it's used by the saliva, and sending that to Dr. Jean Dodd's HemoPet website. So that can come back with some really good information as well. And there are all kinds of foods out here that are AFCO approved that use whole ingredients that we can help with once we have some more scientific data, which really is a nice thing to have. So thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
And we'll wrap up. This is a really cool hot product for dogs, and it got Product of the Year awards. And you can pop this thing out, you can put in treats, pop it back in, and it's nice and squishy. They like to get their mouth around it and pitch it and throw it, and you can clean it in the dishwasher, and it's really done very well. My dog Charlie loves this. So I just thought you might want to take a look at something really funky and fun. That's that. Other than that, have a wonderful Halloween with your dog. Keep them safe. Have a blast. Come out trick-or-treating. There is an event at Godfrey's October 18th. So we have a big Fall Fest Halloween party, so please come out. We do have a slide about our contact information. If you do have that, I'm not sure you still have that. If you have questions for Dog Is Family, you can email dogisfamily@godfreysdogdom.com. And we hope that you stay with us for the next month. We'll be on the second Thursday of the month. And again, thank you so much for joining us. Bye. And thanks again to my guests.
Thank you.